Hello friends, welcome to the Vaibhavas of Anatomy. Here I will discuss the external features of the brain stem. So here you can see the sagittal section of head and neck. Now this brain stem, which extends from the cranial end of spinal cord from here to the diencephalon. This is the diencephalon. So this brain stem extends from here to here. Okay, and it consists of three parts from above downwards. First is the midbrain, this one. Second is the pons, this one, and third one is the medulla oblongata. And below, this brain stem is continuous with the spinal cord. So, where is the junction between this medulla oblongata, means lower part of brain stem, and the spinal cord? So, here you can see the attachment of first cervical nerve, this one. So, the junction between this medulla and the cranial end of spinal cord is the one imaginary horizontal plane, this one, which passes just above the attachment of first cervical nerve here. And this plane corresponds with the upper border of first cervical vertebra, and it also cuts the middle of the odontoid process of second cervical vertebra. Clear? And this brain stem is connected dorsally with the cerebellum, this one, through the three pairs of cerebellar peduncles. Midbrain connected with the cerebellum through the superior cerebellar peduncles on each side, pons with the cerebellum through the middle cerebellar peduncles, and medulla oblongata with the cerebellum through the inferior cerebellar peduncles. But dorsally, this pons and medulla separated from the cerebellum by one cavity, this one, is the fourth ventricle. And anteriorly, the pons rest over this clivus, this is the clivus, which is formed by the fusion of the basilar part of the sphenoid and the basilar part of the occipital bone. But this bone is separated from this clivus by the basilar plexus of veins and the basilar artery. Same, the medulla rests over the basilar part of the occipital bone, but it is separated from this part by the fourth part of vertebral artery, this one, and by the basilar plexus of veins. Now first about the medulla oblongata. So here you can see I have just separated the brain stem from the rest of the parts of the brain. So here you can see this is the midbrain, this is the pons, and this is the medulla oblongata. Now this medulla oblongata, this one, is piriform in shape, and it is about 3 cm in length, 2 cm in breadth, and 1.25 cm in thickness. Now this medulla oblongata extends from the cranial end of spinal cord to the caudal end of pons, this one. And I told you the junction between this medulla and the cranial end of the spinal cord. And the junction between the pons and the cranial end of this medulla is marked by one horizontal sulcus, this one. This is the horizontal sulcus. And this horizontal sulcus gives attachment to three cranial nerves from medial to lateral side. Is the 6th cranial nerve, 7th cranial nerve, and 8th cranial nerves. And this lateral end of horizontal sulcus on both sides is known as cerebellopontile angle, where the three structures meet. One is the medulla, second is the pons, and dorsal is the cerebellum. Now, this medulla oblongata is divided into two symmetrical half by anterior median fissure, this one, and the posteromedial sulcus. This is the posteromedial sulcus, this one. So this anteromedian fissure, this one, is the deep vertical cleft, and below it is continuous with the anterior median fissure of the spinal cord, and above this anterior median fissure ends in a blind recess, this one is known as the foramen of cecum. And in the lower part of medulla oblongata, this anterior median fissure is shallow, this part, because of decussation of the pyramidal fibers, means corticospinal fibers. And this is the posteromedian sulcus, which is a shallow groove, and is continuous with the posteromedian sulcus of the spinal cord below, and above it is continuous with this posterior median sulcus of the floor of the fourth ventricle. Here you can see this is the floor of the fourth ventricle. So this caudal part of the floor of fourth ventricle is formed by this posterior surface of the medulla oblongata, and this cranial part of this floor of fourth ventricle is formed by this posterior or dorsal surface of the pons. Now each half of the medulla oblongata is further subdivided into three parts: anterior part, lateral part and posterior part by two sulci. One is the anterolateral sulci, this one on both sides, and this posterolateral sulci, this one. So this anterior median fissure, anterolateral sulcus and posterolateral sulcus divides the medulla into anterior part, this is the lateral part, and from here to here is the posterior part of the medulla oblongata. So this anterolateral sulcus, this one, is continuous below with the anterolateral sulcus of the spinal cord, and it gives attachment to rootlets of the 12th cranial nerve, means hypoglossal nerve. And this posterolateral sulcus is also below, continuous with the posterolateral sulcus of the spinal cord, and it gives attachment to three cranial nerves craniocaudally, is the 9th cranial nerve, 10th cranial nerve and 11th cranial nerve. Now about the area of medulla oblongata, first the anterior area, this one, which shows the prominent bulging. Here you can see prominent bulging known as the pyramid, which containing the three types of fibers: corticospinal fibers, corticobulbar fibers and the corticopontine fibers. And at the junction between this caudal end of pons and this pyramid is the attachment of the 6th cranial nerve, means abducens nerve. And lateral area, this is the lateral area. So the lateral area shows the one oval shaped bulging, is known as the olive on both sides. Here you can see both sides, this is the olive, and beneath it lies the inferior olivary nucleus. And at the junction between this pons, caudal end of the pons and the olive, is the attachment of the 7th cranial nerve. So here the two roots are there, one is the motor root and second is the sensory root of the facial nerve. This anterior area and lateral area below continuous with the anterior and lateral white funiculus of the spinal cord. Now the posterior area, so from here posterolateral sulci, so this posteromedian sulci is the posterior area of the medulla oblongata. Now this posterior area of medulla is further subdivided into superomedial zone, this open part of the medulla oblongata, and this is the inferolateral zone of the medulla oblongata. Now first about this inferolateral zone of the medulla, so here you can see in the lower part of the inferolateral zone we can see two elevation medially and laterally two more elevation. So medially this elevation are known as the clava or the gracile tubercles, which are the continuation of the fasciculus gracilis from the spinal cord, and beneath it lies the nucleus gracilis. And these two elevation are fused by the V-shaped appendyma, V-shaped seat of appendyma, and laterally two elevation are known as the cuneate tubercle containing the nucleus cuneatus, which are the continuation of fasciculus cuneatus from the spinal cord. Now lateral to this cuneate tubercle two more elevation are there here on both sides, okay. known as the tuber cinereum, containing the nucleus and the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve, which is continuous below with the substantia gelatinosa of Rolando. Clear? So this is the lower part of the inferolateral zone. Now this upper part is the inferior cerebellar peduncle on each side, and through it this medulla is connected with the cerebellum. Now about the superomedial zone, this one, which forms the caudal part of the fourth floor of the fourth ventricle. So above its limit is these horizontal fibers. Here you can see clearly horizontal fibers known as the medullary stria. Clear? Now this open part of medulla oblongata, or this floor of the fourth ventricle, is divided into two half by this posteromedian sulcus, and each half is further subdivided by one more sulcus, is known as the sulcus limitans. Here is the sulcus limitans, and the sulcus limitans below shows this depression. Here you can see depression known as the inferior fovea. Clear? Now medial to the sulcus limitans, this area shows the one trigone, is known as the hypoglossal trigone. Beneath it lies the hypoglossal nucleus, and this lateral area on both sides is the vestibular area, containing the four groups of vestibular nuclei: superior group, inferior group, medial group, and the lateral group. Now below this inferior fovea here, and between this hypoglossal trigone and the vestibular area, this area shows the another trigone, is known as the vagal trigone. Beneath it lies the dorsal nucleus of vagus, and this vagal trigone is further subdivided by this appendymal thickening. Here you can see white color, this appendymal thickening on both sides is known as funiculus saprens, into the lower part known as the area postrema. Here you can see the area postrema, which act as a, or neurons of this area postrema act as a chemoreceptors for the vomiting reflex. So you can see entire part of the floor of fourth ventricle, this caudal part, is resemble the pointed end of writing pen. That's why it is known as the calamus scriptorius. So this is all about the medulla oblongata. Now about the pons. So these pons extend from the cranial end of medulla oblongata to the midbrain, caudal end of midbrain, and this pons is about 2.5 cm in length. And here you can see the ventral surface of the pons. It is convex, and in the middle you can see sulcus, which lodges the basilar artery. And this, on close inspection, this ventral surface shows the transverse ridges and the fissures, which is occupied by the pontocerebellar fibers. And this ventral surface laterally continuous or connected with the cerebellum through the middle cerebellar peduncles. Here you can see the middle cerebellar peduncles, and at the junction between this ventral surface of the pons and the middle cerebellar peduncles, there lies two roots of trigeminal nerve, motor root and the sensory root. Here you can see two roots on each side. Okay, this one. Now the dorsal surface of the pons. So here you can see the dorsal surface of the pons, this one, which forms the cranial part of the floor of the fourth ventricle above the medullary stria, from here to here. Now this cranial part of floor of fourth ventricle is divided into two half by the posteromedian sulcus. Now each half is further subdivided by the sulcus limitans into medial area and lateral area. So this lateral area is the vestibular area, and this medial area is known as the medial eminence. Now the sulcus limitans have on both side have depression. This one is known as the superior fovea, and at the level of superior fovea, the medial eminence presents this elevation on each side, known as the fascial colliculus. Beneath it lies the nucleus of abducens nerve, which is wound round by the motor fibers of fascial nerve. And this lateral area is the vestibular area containing the vestibular group of nuclei. Now the sulcus limitans on both sides above flattens to form the locus ceruleus, which is a bluish gray area. Here you can see bluish gray area is the locus ceruleus, and the neurons of this locus ceruleus are pigmented and known as the substantia ferruginea. So this is all about the pons. Now about the midbrain. It is also known as a mesencephalon, and it is about 2 cm in length, and this midbrain contains the cerebral aqueduct, also known as the aqueduct of Sylvius. You can see here, this one is the aqueduct of Sylvius, which communicates the third ventricle with the fourth ventricle. Here you can see this is the fourth ventricle, and here you can see the midbrain is present in the form of 2 peduncles known as the cerebral peduncles, extend from the cranial end of pons to the diencephalon. Now each peduncle consists of in transverse section from anterior to posterior side. Here you can see transverse section, crus cerebri anteriorly, then tegmentum and the tectum. Most posterior part is the tectum, just behind the coronal plane, which passes through this aqueduct, this one. So this is the coronal plane, and posterior part, this one is the tectum, and anterior part is the tegmentum. And this crus cerebri and the tegmentum separated by this substantia nigra containing the pigmented neurons. Now here you can see one fossa, this one, between these 2 peduncles, and this fossa is known as the interpeduncular fossa. So here you can see the interpeduncular fossa. Here is the pons, medulla, and here you can see 2 cerebral peduncles on each side. So this is the fossa. So this interpeduncular fossa bounded anteriorly by this caudal border of the optic chiasma. Here you can see this is the optic chiasma, so caudal end anteriorly. Posteriorly by this cranial end of pons, anterolaterally on each side by this optic tract, and posterolaterally bounded by these 2 cerebral peduncles. Now this interpeduncular fossa from anterior to posterior side containing the infundibulum with tuberous sinarium and median eminence and pair of mammillary body, here you can see, and posterior perforated substance here, which is pierced by the central branches of the posterior cerebral artery. So this is the interpeduncular fossa. So these 2 peduncles form the posterolateral boundary of this interpeduncular fossa, and this peduncle on both sides crosses by the structures from above downwards, and the structures are the optic tract, then basal vein, then posterior cerebral artery and the superior cerebellar artery, and 2 more structures cross this peduncle on both sides are the trochlear nerve and oculomotor nerve, which lie between this posterior cerebral artery and the superior cerebellar artery. So just medial to this peduncle here is the median sulcus, means junction between this interpeduncular fossa and the cerebral peduncle, and laterally having a lateral sulcus. So this medial sulcus gives attachment to oculomotor nerve, and lateral sulcus gives attachment to trochlear nerve. Now about the dorsal surface or tectum of the midbrain. Here you can see the tectum of the midbrain, which shows the four elevation: superiorly two elevation, inferiorly two elevation. So the superiorly two elevation are known as the superior colliculi, and inferiorly are known as the inferior colliculi. And these four colliculi, two superior, two inferior, are separated by one cruciform sulcus. So this vertical limb of this cruciform sulcus above having a one depression here, and this depression lodges the pineal gland. And caudally means below, this vertical limb continues with the frenulum veli. This is the frenulum veli on the dorsal surface of the superior medullary velum. This is the superior medullary velum. Now the superior colliculi on each side connected laterally with the lateral geniculate body through the raised band. Here you can see the raised band on each side, known as the superior brachium. And the inferior colliculi laterally connected with the medial geniculate body through this inferior brachium. So the superior colliculi act as a subcortical center for the visual reflexes, and inferior colliculi act as a subcortical center for the auditory reflexes. So this is all about the brain stem, midbrain, pons and the medulla. Thank you.
If you like our video, click on the like button and share with your friends. To get the regular updates on anatomy video by Viva Voice of Anatomy, subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon.